Let's learn about Beemats next on Gardener's Hotline. Gardener's Hotline. I'm your host, Karen Stauderman, a University of Florida horticulture extension agent. Beemats are islands of plants floating on mats, built to any size and shape to occupy a lake, a retention pond, or aquatic habitat. By using interlocking mats combined with aquatic plants in perforated pots, Beemats suspend a simulated shallow water environment. This not only takes care of fluctuating water levels, but also produces oxygen. It takes nutrients and pesticides out of the water and provides a habitat for wildlife utilization. Meet Forrest Beeman, owner of Beeman's Nursery in New Smyrna Beach, Florida. He's the developer of Beemats. Welcome to the show, Forrest.
Thank you, Karen.
Now, I'd like to invite all of you at home to call in with your questions for Forrest at 1-800-901-9238. Well, Forrest, tell me a little bit about what goes on at Beeman's Nursery and how you developed Beemats.
Well, Beemats were developed a while back with me and my father, Steve. He's a marine biologist, I'm a horticulturalist, and it was kind of a natural fit.
Well, it sure sounds like it. Mm-hmm. Now, you also have a nursery there. Tell me, what kind of nursery is that?
It's a native wholesale nursery. We grow mostly native grasses and native aquatics. Now, those are designed mostly for wetlands, so that's our history is building and creating wetlands.
Wow, what a perfect fit.
It was. And we started off, we were creating wetlands for a long time, since the 70s with my father. And then as I came along, we started working more and more on golf courses, homeowner sites, things like that.
Well, Forrest, it's such a great idea. I'm just surprised there's not more developed faster or sooner for these great ideas. Why don't you walk me through how they're done?
All right. Well, Beemats are simply a closed cell foam mat that we use to grow plants hydroponically. Small 3-inch cups with native aquatics in them are used to take nutrients out of the water. So what we're doing here is we are planting all of our aquatic plants in these islands. These islands can float freely, anchored to the bottom, and swing around to affect as much water as possible. They also have an aesthetic value to it, the homeowners. Homeowners often find these things very pleasing to the eye and something that adds beauty to their neighborhoods. And they also create habitat for wildlife. For the most part, though, what they're designed to do is to remove the nutrients from the water and cut down on algae blooms, fish kills, and other environmentally hazardous problems we have.
Well, once you put a Beemat into a lake, how long does it take before you start to see an improvement in the lake quality?
Oftentimes, just a few months until we start seeing a great reduction in the nutrients. Almost immediately, the plants are taking nutrients from the water, and we can see a reduction in some of those problems.
Looks like a lot of wildlife like them, too.
Wildlife really do. They find a lot of habitat there, protected away from what we as humans have, a lot of yards, so they can be out there and have their habitat, eat, use it as a fishery, use it as a place to hunt and live and nest.
Now, when you have those habitats, I mean, a lot of them look a lot like grasses. Are there any other designs that you have that you can make out of Beemats? Can you change the plants out and bring some color in?
Yeah, the beauty of our design is that the plants are removable. Removable plants mean you can change out the palette, the different species of plants you use. It also means if you have a weed problem at any time or other problems where you just want to change your mind, you can change the plants out intermittently, seasonally, or just because you want to.
Now, does hydrilla interfere with these islands?
No. Hydrilla is not a weed that would get onto it. They float underneath the water. So hydrilla is typically a problem in our stormwater ponds here in Florida, but they're actually reduced in lakes because the Beemats are out competing the hydrilla. So they're reduced in that lake because of the Beemats.
Okay, once a Beemat is out there, how deep do the roots get? Because it's kind of misleading. It looks like the roots can go very deep, but how deep do they really get?
Yeah, the roots we found on average are about 18 inches deep, hanging in the water. So the mat is only a couple inches deep, but the roots can hang up to 18 inches deep. So we like the mats to be in at least about 18 inches of water.
Oh, so that's the minimum. So if somebody has a lake in their backyard, they must have at least 18 inches.
That's right.
So year-round.
That's right. Year-round. And if it doesn't, if it was to dry up, the mats are still relatively lightweight and small. You can remove the plants, roll up the island, and wait for the water to come back.
Wow, what a great idea. Mm-hmm. Now, how long does it take before your plants outgrow their little cell?
In our environments here in Florida, we have cold enough winters to where most of the aquatics will kind of start to die back in the winter. And so we change out the species that can be a little more winter hardy, cold hardy. But where if we did a contracted job down in Costa Rica, they can grow theirs year round.
Now, does the harsh sun, the Florida sun, break down the substrate of the mat?
No, we found that the plants quickly mature to a point where they cover up the mat completely. The UV can't get through the plants, it's shaded out, so the mats are protected from the sun in that sense. Plus, in the scenarios that they aren't fully, the UV hasn't been enough of a cause of breakdown.
So how long does it take to establish once you've put a mat together and put it out in the pond?
Well, immediately you'll start seeing growth. The more nutrients in the water, the more the plants will grow. And so if you have a lot of algae, that's a good clue that you have lots of nutrients.
Well, why don't we take a look at some of the variety that you have on Beemats available to see what we can look at for some selections. Tell me a little bit about them.
So a lot of our islands are going to have tall aquatics in the middle, and those aquatics are going to have flowers. They're going to have yellow flowers in the canna, white flowers in the arrowhead. The irises will have blue and yellow flowers as long as and as well as pickerelweed has purple flowers.
Now, seasonal, like spring and summer?
Most of those will grow most of our year here in Florida. South Florida will grow all year round. North Florida, they'll stop around this time of year, anytime in the fall.
All right, and now you have some that definitely look like a floating island.
Oh, that's right, yes. Some of these get mistaken as actual land masses that people could walk on. They're not. They are small, thin, close-cell foam, floating on the surface, and they have plants growing through them down into the water, and so they have some structure to them, they have some weight to them, but for the most part, what you're looking at is just plants.
So can we walk on them?
You can't walk on them. They're not structurally sound enough to walk on, whereas alligators distribute their weight a little better. We have lots of alligators that use our islands to sun on.
Wow. All right. I like these. Look at the symmetry of these.
We have a lot of examples where some ponds we put one island in, other ponds they have many sources of water either coming and going, so they like to move the islands around and put several islands into one pond so that they can put them in front of any outfall structures or any water coming into that pond.
How do you keep them from moving around the lake?
They're used just like a sailboat. We anchor them to the bottom, and usually just weight is what we use, either a concrete structure in a small island, cinder blocks, things like that.
And that's attached to the mat itself.
And then we bring that up and we attach that to the mat. We usually use a stainless steel grommet as a place for an anchoring point, things like that. But they'll swing around like a sailboat would swing around with the wind, always facing the wind.
What if they ever get to the end of the bank? What would happen then? Do you have to yank them back out in the middle?
We try to make sure that we don't ever let there be enough slack in the rope that they could get to the bank. In high water levels, you might get it over to the bank, and as the water recedes, they could be stranded, and just like a boat being stranded on a sandbar, they could get stuck there. So what we'd like to do is try to avoid that by properly anchoring it in the deeper areas.
Boy, I see it. It looks like it's a wonderful water habitat. There's even nesting for waterfowl.
A lot of waterfowl, a lot of wading birds. The biggest attraction that we find is things like spoonbills, egrets, herons, fishing on our shorelines of our artificial habitat here.
Well, those are pretty big birds. And now, what is this apparatus? Something that's putting it into the lake.
It is. So we have several different kinds of ways that we can install islands into lakes. This is a trailer launch, and this is a way we can put islands together on land and then launch them into the water without ever getting into the water. We use the same type of apparatus using a crane for really steep banks and areas that are hard to get into or really steep shorelines to where we can't stand in the water.
Now, this is pretty a nice one for urban area. Can you change the colors out for a holiday theme? Can you, without much trouble?
Certainly. This one was done as an art project. Art projects are kind of common in my world now. We have more and more landscape architects and advertisers using Beemats to either accentuate a sign, accentuate a season, accentuate in a course of a golf course, it would be a tournament. So they're used in all different ways to bring attention to something, either a sign or, like you said, a season. If we wanted to change the fall colors out or seasonal spring colors out, we could do that.
Well, where can we find some of these bee mats already in nature? Where have you placed them?
We have several counties around the state of Florida. Volusia County, Brevard County, Lee County, Collier County, Lake County, probably too many for me to name. Outside of the state of Florida, we've moved into several different states. We have Kansas and Tennessee, Colorado, California. Outside of the United States, we have Canada, oddly enough, and Costa Rica and Spain. We also have some calls from South Africa recently.
Wow, these are worldwide locations.
Starting to get there, yes.
And they're cleaning up their lakes with this?
All used just to remove nutrients and clean up their lakes.
Of course, like I said, this is such a great idea. I'm just so surprised it wasn't developed earlier.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, we were surprised too. When we started doing the research, that we didn't find anybody else doing it. So what we'd found was a lot of history of Chinese using bamboo reeds to grow these things and natural lakes, floating wetlands as well, but nothing done commercially.
Now, I know people are going to ask me, what's the general price on something like this?
General price for just the hardware without the plants is going to be around $3 to $3.50 per square foot.
Well, that's pretty affordable.
Mm-hmm.
And so the plants, you can change those out, and that would be a matter of choice of what the homeowner wants to put in there.
That's right. Plants are going to vary in price. Florida, good news is here in Florida, plants are pretty inexpensive. In other states, can be more expensive, so obviously the price would go up in other states.
It's another win-win for Florida.
It is.
We have a caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question for Forrest today? Go ahead, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question?
Hi, I was just wondering.
Go ahead.
I just turned it here right now. And what kind of material they use to be the squares?
Well, that's a good question for us. Why don't we go right into that and you discuss us a little bit about what it's made of?
Okay, EVA foam is a closed cell foam that we used. This is the same type of mats that you will find in a children's play area. And it is a half inch thick, so it's not very thick, but very buoyant. Has a very high buoyancy.
Now, is this safe for wildlife?
It is safe for wildlife. It doesn't deteriorate in the UV. The water doesn't break it down, and it's safe enough that they can walk on it. They can live on it. They don't have any pores in it, so because it is closed cell, meaning it doesn't have any open pores, it won't break down, and therefore won't leach into the water.
And I want to let the viewers know, this looks like a child's play mat that they'd find at a daycare or a playground. Now, Forrest, will this work in salt water, in fresh water, in brackish water?
Salt water, fresh water, brackish water, all types of water the mat does astonishingly well in. Obviously, what you're choosing in that scenario is the correct plant species. And correct plant species meaning you need saltwater plants for saltwater, brackish. Therefore, not the same plant species you could find everywhere. You have to find your water quality first before we decide which plants you're going to use.
How close to the ocean have you set one of these out? Because obviously in the ocean, there's some limitations.
There would be. In the ocean, it would be, such a big ocean. It would be very hard, a lot of wave action, a lot of navigation problems in the ocean. The closest we've come, a lot of stormwater ponds near the ocean, a lot of in the Indian River Lagoon and Mosquito Lagoons, a lot of stormwater ponds leading to those areas that we do treat. We have tried a island in a canal down south, and a manatee decided to use it as a salad bar. So
oh,
we decided to stay out of navigable waters where manatees like to swim. But other than that, we're very Animal friendly.
Now, great. Will water skiers run into this, and what happens if they do? Is it a soft landing, or?
It would be a soft landing if they ran into it. We haven't yet put these in the way of water skiers. It would be a navigation hazard if placed in a somewhere where boating happens, so we try to stay out of that. The boat wake action wouldn't be a problem. It's not a issue of the mats being okay. It's an issue of safety in those scenarios.
I see.
We wouldn't want it to where it could hurt anybody, so we keep them out of those areas.
Now we have another caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question today? Go ahead, caller.
Hello.
Hi. Go ahead with your question.
I'm not hearing anything.
Go ahead, caller. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Go ahead with your question.
Oh, good. I work in an office park in Winter Park, Florida, and we have a nice lake outside the window, and I'm seeing these little island thingies in natural form, and what really, really fascinates me is seeing animals come around them, ibises, egrets, turtles, all kinds of animals that come around that. Please talk to me about the hierarchy of, animals and plants and how this interacts with what you're doing.
Great. That was a great question. And what we'll say about that is the reason the birds and the other bigger wildlife that you can see, those big animals, is because it's creating habitat for all the smaller animals, as small down as to zooplankton and the roots. The roots, this is a big science thing, but the roots create a biofilm that has things like zooplankton and other
fish food,
basically. Things that also eat the algae and do beneficial things down in the roots. They also add up, and it keeps going to the smaller fish to the bigger fish, and those up to the things like invertebrates that attach themselves to it, snails, little kind of clams, things like that. But it gets up to the birds that you can actually see. They're there for a reason. They're actually using it as a habitat to eat, to nest, and to live. I don't know if that completely answered the question, but that's a good summary of why they're there.
And that's all animals, rats and snakes and...
Any animal that we find native here in Florida will find, and that like aquatic scenario, environments, will love the Beemats to live on. They won't, they'd have to swim to it because it is away from the shoreline. So if it is an animal like a dog or a cat, you won't find it on these islands. What you'd find is mostly things like turtles, alligators, anything that will swim, and we'll get out there to them.
So actually, was there any close calls? Have you ever had any encounters with any of them when you were maintaining these?
Yeah. Oddly enough, we do see lots of alligators. We see lots of water moccasins here in Florida. Nothing that I would call a close counter, but enough to scare a couple of my employees. A couple times we have to back off and shoo a couple snakes away.
Now, is this a magnet for wildlife like that, or is it the same amount? They're just off your banks now and onto the islands.
You would think that it would be the same. The thing I can tell you is that with less human traffic, with less dogs and things to bark it away, this is now a place where we can have our habitat go and have safe refuge from us in a lot of ways. So knowing that these animals are going to be there, they're going to be there naturally, this gives them a place to live and to be without being a nuisance to us. So if we think of it like that, then it is more or less a magnet.
I like that.
Mm-hmm.
We have another caller on the line. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question today? Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question?
Oh, yeah, this show is about aquatic plants, right? And I was just wondering if you can grow a certain type of plant to attract piranha and barracuda.
If I was a better horticulturalist, I might be able to answer that. Certain types of plants that would attract fish in general, yeah, that's going to be our main issue here. If we're attracting anything that's a predatory fish towards other predator to other fish, yes, obviously any type of habitat that you're creating with a root system that creates a nice protective area for eggs of other fish and other animals, then that would create small fish and shrimp and things like that would be living in the thing. That'll bring in predatory fish. like piranha and like barracuda. Yeah.
Well, tell me a little bit about some of the plants we have here. This is a gardening show, so I'm more excited than the plants here. Tell me a little bit about what we've got.
Okay. Well, this is a bent grass that we found that would be very aquatic. We've used it in our Beemats. Most every application in fresh water. This is a freshwater application plant that we use. It's done great here for us. It takes out lots of nutrients and does a great job. But more what it does is it adds a nice border around our islands. And that border has something for the turtles to sit on, something for the alligators to lay on without crushing some of our more succulent plants that could be kind of crushed just by the weight. They're not necessarily there to eat them, but if they lay on them enough, they will crush them and kind of, you know, damage the plants. These being grasses can be laid on and they'll bounce right back. That's more the reason why we use them more than anything, but they also do a great job at nutrient removal. Then beyond that, we start putting in some of our natives. This is an example of an arrowhead. And arrowhead is used, has a white flower, real beautiful, and does a great job at removing nutrients.
Does this have a flower?
It does. It has a white flower, and it gets a real tall lance leaf. Looks like a blade of a spear. Is the foliage looks really beautiful. Yellow canna, we're familiar with cannas. Cannas have different varieties. Our native canna is a golden canna or a yellow canna. It has a brilliant yellow flower, really pretty in this in the Beemat application. We use that a lot. Soft rush is another plant that we use a lot. Soft rush, the reason we use soft rush mostly is because it's more evergreen, used a lot, grows mostly year round, and is a all-star in terms of nutrient removal. Takes up a large amount of nutrients out of our water.
But you wouldn't want a whole island of that.
We wouldn't want a whole island only because aesthetically. If your sole purpose was to remove nutrients, then I have no problem putting in a monoculture of just soft rush or any species for that matter. If you're specifically going for a specific target, we can do that application as well.
What's the oldest mat you've got right now in service?
Right now we have a saltwater DOT pond in New Smyrna Beach that is 6 years old. And it's in saltwater, so it is a very harsh environment and has proven to be our most successful. It's really great, but that's the oldest one we've done so far.
Now, if you take a look at this, this is just literally a mat with holes.
That's right.
Now, and this is what? This
Oh, pallet. That's just a wooden frame to represent us floating this island.
But that's not in the water. It's simply
not
the mat.
It's just simply the mat. The wooden frame here has nothing to do with what I am providing.
And on our back wall is an example of a larger set, a couple of them put together.
That's right. It's a relatively small island, but over my shoulders, there is a larger island using clips, washers, and what we call our plastic permalon strip. It's our anchoring strip that goes across the center of it. Like we said, this is a very small example just for the show. What we usually have is our sheets come in 4-foot by 8-foot sections that are linked together, and up to most of my islands are around 500 square feet, but can go up to 2,000 square feet in size. Obviously, a 4-foot by 8-foot island could be cut down to a smaller backyard size. We can cut them up, make them as small, just like this sample for something like a koi pond, let's say.
Well, we have one more quick call I'd like to take. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question for Forrest today?
Hi, I was wondering if he had any plans on using this widespread throughout the Indian River Lagoon to clean the lagoon up. This is fantastic. I can't believe how neat, what a neat idea he's come up with.
Well, I appreciate that call more than you'd know. The Indian River Lagoon, much like most of our waters of the state, meaning natural bodies of water, our lagoons, our rivers, and our ocean need to be protected. The way the state is going to address this and the way we decided to address this is we are going after all the stormwater ponds that lead to those areas. Grant money can be found to clean up specifically the Indian River Lagoon, but most of the money that we'll find to clean up our waters are going to come to stormwater, DOT, things like that. And that's really where we need to clean it up, is these small stormwater ponds where they're controlled. And all the waters leading to that need to be done well.
Now, can we also put some solar lights on it? Because if I'm outside at night, it's got to look good. Can we have some sort of an insect trap to keep the mosquitoes off our water bodies, or pheromones or something to make this look beautiful at night when we look out on our lakes?
That is a great imagination, and I love it. I think it's a great idea. These islands will certainly either surround another floating something like a sign, a fountain, or any other contraption that you have out there that would be floating. Or, in this scenario, this has plenty of flotation to remove some of these plants and place something like lights, or you can add something directly to this mat, and it could be adapted to this mat as well.
I didn't even think about signs. It would make a great advertising. If lights can change, signs can change. Boy, I hate to, you know, make nature look worse and market it, but, you know, I never thought about that on some of those intercoastals.
Many advertisers are starting to see this as an opportunity, especially in things you'll see like a golf tournament or something like that. Well, they'll have a sign in the water. Well, this is a way to put flowers and beautiful natives in a lot of cases. Also, depending on what plants you use, the texture and color of those plants can make a design within the island. Not only the shape and cut of the island, but within that island, you can use the plants to design something like a name or a logo.
Wow, like the Florida Gators.
That would be great.
Well, that's all the time that we have for today. And I'd like to thank Forrest Beeman for his visit on today's program about Beemats, and thank all of you for tuning in tonight and being a part of the show. If you didn't get your question answered, email me at wdsc@daytonastate.edu. Creating artificial wetlands like Beemats looks promising to help deal with the stormwater pollution. What a great idea for many lakes of Florida. Please join me again next week on another edition of Gardener's Hotline.